Good morning. We're all juiced and refreshed here. I'd like to start by introducing our panel that will be making up our next two-hour session. We're delighted today, as has been mentioned earlier, to have these four gentlemen here to join us. First of all, I'd like to introduce Ted Black. And Ted, I want to tell you, while you were not here, Steve Cass shared a few interesting stories, more to come, I'm sure. Ted Black is president of the Buffalo Sabres, oversees all aspects of the day-to-day operations of the franchise with specific focus on making the Buffalo Sabres the premier destination for NHL players and the Sabres' current and future employees. Mr. Black has compiled a track record of success and experience that few sports executives can match. And as we all know, he happens to be a graduate of where? Allegheny College. Okay. David Lowe, also joining us today, he's a shareholder and director of Sherrard, German and Kelly, PC, and a member of the firm's corporate and financial services group. He concentrates his practice in mergers and acquisitions, sports law, securities law, finance and venture capital, oil and gas, banking, and general corporate matters. He also represents buyers, sellers, companies, and financing transactions. David Zigai serves as Vice President of Legal and Administrative Affairs for the Buffalo Sabres. He's a graduate of Cornell University in Business, Sports Administration from Canisius College, his law degree from the University of Buffalo Law School. The moderator today for the panel discussion will be Eric Springer. He's shareholder and director of Sherrard, German and Kelly, PC, and is a member of the firm's corporate litigation and financial services group. He also is chairman of the firm's finance committee. Mr. Springer's practice includes a wide range of corporate and financial institution services. Mr. Springer frequently serves as outside corporate counsel to financial institutions and mid-sized companies. And he also happens to be a graduate of Allegheny College. So those of us that are not graduates of Allegheny College, more and more this morning wish we were. I'd like to turn this back to Greg Peterson. He's got a little introductory.
Please follow the bouncing ball. First of all, this is being filmed. If you have one of these, please turn it off. As some of you recall, in late April of this year, we had a wonderful CLE entitled Woodstock, the Music of the First Amendment. We had a terrific turnout, terrific response, and the challenge was try to top that one. And we have. And here's how it happened. Clearly, during that time period, the biggest news out of Western New York was the acquisition of the Buffalo Sabres by Terry Pegula. And I was hoping against hope that we could figure out a way to take advantage in the fall of that enthusiasm. But how do we make this happen? What's the connect? Where does it all fit together? And here's how it happened. Ted, you don't know, remember this probably, but you were waiting in the waiting room to join, I think it was the Buffalo Club, and there was a young associate of Phillips Lytle, Steve Presbula, also waiting to be interviewed for this particular membership. Idle chatter occurred. I had mentioned to Steve, gee, I've got to figure out a way to get Ted Black. I want Ted Black. He's a lawyer. I'd love to have him come down and talk about this. And then Steve, in his idle chatter with you, Ted, found out that you were from Allegheny College. And he further found out that you were a Phi Delta. Now, I'm a lawyer. I'm from Allegheny College, and I'm a Phi Delta. Aha! The hook. But is it a good enough hook to get him down here? So I'm talking at an event, and there is one Judge Steve Cass. And I said, gee, Ted Black, Allegheny College, Phi Delta. Steve goes, well, let me tell you one better. I was his fraternity big brother. Oh, this is getting better. And then he says, I'll text him. I'll text him and tell him you're going to be calling him. That's outstanding. And then it started to spin. I said, wow, we can turn this into an Allegheny College moment, because there are other Allegheny College lawyers all over the place, and lawyers are good to give CLE, and this is wonderful. That led to catching up with Kathy Wilcox, now Panabianco, who will be here taking photographs, who is married to George Panabianco, also from Allegheny College, baseball player, our resident advisor, which then led to Byron Balicki. My God, Byron Allegheny FIDO lawyer. And then I call over there, and this had to be one of the funniest things that happened as part of this world of serendipity. I call, and there's a gatekeeper. If you try to call Byron directly, forget about it. There's a gatekeeper, and this lovely lady was on the phone and said, hey, I'd like to talk to Byron Balicki. She said, about what? I'd like to talk to Byron about Ted Black. Oh, you mean my brother? I said, no, you're not. Ted Black. No, I know, she says, the president of the Buffalo Sabres. I paused and said, I'd rather talk to you. And I did. She was discreet. She didn't say a lot. But ultimately, that got Byron involved. Well, we have now three of the four in the early morning, and we got to fill out the dance card. And, of course, our county executive, Greg Edwards, also a lawyer, Allegheny FIDO. And he, too, had no choice, principally because I've heard that there may be stories that involve you and him, which I understand will not be discussed today. All of this was a wonderful introduction to Ted, which, in turn, I stalked you. You may not know that.
I didn't know that.
And you were kind enough to invite Dave McNamara and Phillips Lytle to an event at the club, Odd Club, and there, that's when we stalked you in. Armed with all of this information from Cass, Balicki, Edwards, he said, okay, let's find a date. Now, it further gets better, because I thought, wouldn't it be great to include the law firm who was actually involved in the acquisition? And doing a little research, thanks to Martindale Hubble and Google, we could find out that it's the law firm of German Sherrard, which is here. And Erich Springer was, in fact, Allegheny College lawyer FIDO. Beautiful. So I call Erich, and he prevailed upon David to come up. And then we learn more. David Zigai, in-house counsel, UB, outstanding. And they're all here today to talk about the acquisition of the Buffalo Sabres. Now, in talking to Ted, it was a brief conversation, and he was to the point. He goes, Greg, let me be perfectly clear about this deal. It was $180 million. It was a cash deal. It was a stock transaction. How can I fill out an hour and a half of that? I responded. I said, no, you bought more than just the stock of the Buffalo Sabres. So to give us a flavor for what they actually bought, we're going to show a brief introduction to kind of get the juices flowing.
Takes his shot, he scores!
Tis the season! Follow!
Charging after it, clear right out in front, backhand by Hannon, he scores!
Now do you believe? Sit back, relax, there's much more where that came from. Hi, I'm Kevin Sylvester. Today you will see and hear the best of over 30 years of Rick Jenneret calling Buffalo Sabres hockey games. But before we hear from Rick, we'd like to say thanks. Proceeds of the sale of this DVD go to the Buffalo Sabres Foundation, a not-for-profit foundation committed to enhancing the quality of life in Western New York and Southern Ontario. The foundation strives to assist worthwhile organizations that make this region a better place to live and work. For more information, you can read the foundation's mission statement on our website, sabres.com. Now, on with the show. Rick Jennerette truly is top shelf. He's the longest tenured announcer in the NHL, starting as a Sabres radio voice just 1 year into the team's existence.
Off the Stanfield. Stanfield in front to Martin. He shoots right on the crease. The Sabres score!
Not only is his voice a great voice, but his inflection is amazing. He seems to rise as the team gets closer to opportunity and scoring opportunities. His vocabulary is amazing.
Spell that one, H-U-S-T-L-E, all hustle.
Rick Jennerette.
Around, but not out.
La-la-la-la-la-Fontaine.
La-la-la-la-la-Fontaine. It's fun to hear a holy macro.
And a whack! And another whack!
And he scores!
I can't do it like he does.
He's got a breakaway! Becca walking right in, scores! Michael Becca, top shelf where Mama hides the cookies!
My mom, God bless her, is still very much around, and she never hid the cookies on me, but she certainly limited the number I could have.
Got it in front, the shot, it scores! Randy Burridge, top shelf where Mama hides the cookies!
It's a call that actually I had heard way, way, way back when.
And again, backhand, forehand, scores! Derek Webb, top shelf where Mama hides the cookies!
And, I've forgotten all about it for years and years, and then I was working with Larry Playfair on radio one night, and he referenced it, and I thought, well, it's time to dust that baby off.
There's another shot, they score! Maxim Finneganoff, top shelf where Mama hides the cookies!
My son Daniel, he's a huge Sabres fan, as I am, and we happen to, you know, whenever the Sabres are, Dad, the Sabres are playing, we got to listen to Rick Jennerette. And to this day, all the kids on our hockey team, when they score top shelf, it's, you know, top shelf where Mama hides the cookies.
His passion for the game and the fact that he knows it, he understands, and he sees plays developing, so he knows where the pass could go.
Vanek getting it over the line, looking for the trailer.
And so you hear the inflection in his voice as the pass goes where he's anticipating it, and then maybe the pass back.
Vanek hanging onto the puck, gives it to Roy, to Vanek, to Roy!
And he can build up in his voice what's about to happen because
Vanek
he understands
scores!
How a goal could be scored, and or a great save.
Pick it up and fire it to center ice, and a breakaway, who's had to clear the net? And he checks Brian Savage and locks it away from him.
The color guy, and we had Barry Butel, and we had this little booth and box in the old auditorium. There wasn't a lot of room. I had papers everywhere, and Rick just had the lineup. And I remember real succinctly when Pat LaFontaine was traded here. And I'll never forget this story because Patty came in his first game, and you know, he had an assist, I think, in the first period, and everybody was kind of excited that Patty was there. And then in the second period, he scored his first goal as a Sabre. And Rick got up, he stood up like this, put his arms like this against Barry and myself, like, shut up, don't say anything. Like, it was, I've never seen him do this before. And then the next thing that came out of his mouth was, la 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 la. I almost fell out of the box. I mean, he planned it so well, and that call is, you know, has been famous ever since.
I heard it the first, the night after I scored the goal, and I remember the guys telling me that, you gotta hear this.
That one just came, that popped up. I mean, I didn't think about that whatsoever. However, it might have been an extension of when Pierre Turgeon played in Buffalo. And I used to say, ooh la la, Pierre. Maybe that was the seed that was planted, but it just popped out when Patty scored his first goal against Hartford, and I still remember it very, very well.
I'll be walking on the street. I won't even be in Buffalo. I'll be in Long Island or somewhere else. And I'll hear someone in the background going, la 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 la, you know, LaFontaine. And so it's amazing the weight that his voice carries.
LaFontaine! And this one is all tied at two!
in many ways, I look back at my career, and even now you see a highlight or hear something, it doesn't seem right unless you hear Rick Jeanneret calling that goal.
La Fontaine, the tis the season one was always a good one.
Well, tis the season! Fa la 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 Fontaine!
There's just calls where you wonder, was he sitting at home? Did he have this, you know, and I've asked him, I said, come on, RJ, you've got that one sitting on a piece of paper and you're just waiting for the right moment. And, you know, he swears that they're all instantaneous. And to come up with some of the calls that he does come up with, there are some that are heartfelt. There are some that make you laugh. But there are no bad ones.
Pegula looking for the pass and gets it. And again, oh, couldn't get the shot away. Now he does. Oh. He scores! Holy mackerel, roll the highlight film! Maxima Pinnikinoff, what a move!
Connolly cutting through center, hitting the Edmonton line, busts through the defense, shoots one, scores! Oh my goodness! Did I use that phrase somewhere? Roll the highlight film!
With me, and I just love it when he does that.
Pat slides in over the line, Pat took a shot!
And then the next goal that was a lot of fun to be around was Dave Hannon's backhand to win that game in four overtimes. And Paddy LaFontaine was in the booth with us. And it was a long night, four overtimes, and RJ keeps... And again, if you listen to that game, his voice got a little bit tired, but who's wouldn't after seven or eight periods? And when the goal went in, he kind of... Well, there was a couple of times he turned to us, and it was like we just said... Because there was great saves and whatnot. And Paddy or I would give him like a one-word answer, like wow or awesome or something. And he's going, that's the best you can do. What he was looking for us to do was come up with some filler time to say some stuff so he can catch his breath and have a drink of water or something. And we were like two fans, Paddy and I, watching this silly hockey game, listening to RJ tell us what was going on. And it was, and then when the goal went in, it was awesome.
Can't get it to Presley, gets it again. Daw charging after it, clear to right out in front, backhand by Hannon, he scores! Dave Hannon is mobbed by his teammates! Dave Hannon finally put away the backhand, and this series is going back to where Jimmy Hoffa is, back to the Meadowlands in New Jersey!
That was a reach. That was really a reach. I was trying to think of something else to say, and I just came up with that. A series is going back to where Jimmy Hoffa's buried. I don't even know he's buried there or not. They just said that he was buried in the Meadowlands. Somebody told me that somewhere along the line. They still haven't found him. I know that.
That was a pretty special night for myself, but also for my teammates in Buffalo. It was a great night.
Get up to LaFontaine, he gets tripped up, gets it to May, and over the line, here's May going in on goal, he shoots, he scores!
I remember that call, Mayday, Mayday, Mayday. How do you spell second round? I mean, it was like, you know, where the heck did he come with that?
And I've been asked about that numerous times, and people said, did you plan on it? Did you plan on using the Mayday call? And I think Brad May had gone something like 18 games without scoring a goal. Now, I'm going to pick Brad May and come up with something and plan on something. He, of all people, who hadn't scored in forever, in the biggest game to the Buffalo Sabres playoff run up until then? No, absolutely not. That one just was another one that just popped out.
And you hear RJ as Brad beats Bork.
Bring it up to LaFontaine, he gets tripped up, gets it to May, and over the line, here's May!
RJ's voice goes up, because he's anticipating something, because that was Ray Bourque that Brad just beat.
Going in on goal, he shoots, he scores!
Granby came around, Deke Ray Bourque out of his skates and Andy Mook out of his, you know what, and just put it in the net.
And then the fans helped as well, but it was the Mayday, 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 and the place was going bananas.
It's my ringtone on my cell phone right now, so I just love it. You know, Daddy's, he came up with that.
He's forever given me a nickname, so I'm indebted to Rick.
Oh, no, do you believe?
I think one of the moments that stick in my mind was against the Ottawa Senators last season when Jason Pominville scored the goal.
Pominville into Ottawa territory. Pominville goes around Albertson, cuts in front, scores! Jason Pominville, shorthanded! Oh, now do you believe? Now do you believe? These guys are good, scary good!
And he came up with the line, now do you believe? Now do you believe? I mean, every time I hear it, it gives me goosebumps.
To be able to hear it after and hear how crazy you went, it was great to see. And I mean, all the guys got a laugh, but it was really enjoyable.
For him to come up with that, these guys are good, scary good. When we watched that game, I remember as exciting as the goal was, that made it. It made the hair on the back of my neck stand up. It really did.
I can tell you that it kind of fit in with Now Do You Believe, because I think maybe it goes back, though, to the start of the season when absolutely nobody picked the Buffalo Sabres to make the playoffs. And then all of a sudden, in the playoffs, everybody started to say, hey, this club's not so bad after all. And last year's team provided so many great moments, and particularly the way the team played the entire way. At the end of the season, when they finally lost in Carolina, I went down to the dressing room and I saw every emotion in there. I saw the resignation, I saw the tears, saw the anger and everything. And I just walked around the room and shook hands with every player that I could see and congratulated them for a great season and told them that it was the best year of my life, and it was, as far as hockey was concerned, absolutely slam dunk. Forget about going to the finals in the 2 years. That was wonderful. This was wonderful.
One shot, deflects in front, they score! Thomas Fennec is there to shovel it home. Do you believe Buffalo wins another one in all?
You've come here to learn about the acquisition of the Buffalo Sabres, and it all starts with Terry Pegula and the man in black, Ted Black. Ted?
Greg, you took my seat.
Thanks, Greg, and thanks, everyone, for being here. This is a... didn't know what to expect. I certainly didn't expect a big crowd like this, so this is very humbling. Now that apparently I have the microphone and the Honorable Judge Cass does not, I guess I can deviate a little bit from my remarks. First off, you know, Judge, you should know that you can't try anyone in absentia. And it sounds like any of the evidence you had was needed to be corroborated based on your credibility. And also, the one time I did need you for your judicial expertise to get a restraining order on Greg Peterson, you were nowhere to be found either. So, but thank you again, everyone. And especially, I want to thank the warm welcome that I've received. I'm sort of the Connecticut Yankee in King Arthur's Court, being a displaced Pittsburgher and moving to Western New York, and And the welcome that I've received, I've been in Jamestown a couple times now speaking, and it's really, it's humbling. You know, it reminds me, too, that, you know, the Buffalo Sabres fan base certainly extends far beyond Erie County and all over the world, quite frankly, because we saw it when we were in Germany. But it's this may be the soul of Buffalo Sabres country right here in Jamestown, so I really appreciate that. And I also want to thank you on behalf of the Pegula family as well. The end of last month marked eight month anniversary from Terry buying the team. We've worked really hard in the last 8 months, primarily to change the image of the Buffalo Sabres, to change the image of Western New York in general, and Buffalo in particular, when it comes to trying to attract hockey players and get them to stay. We know once they come to Buffalo, they fall in love with it and stay. We have probably the highest number of NHL alumni that live in any city here in Buffalo that have decided to make it their homes. So we know that, but we wanted to change the perception to make Buffalo a hockey destination. And we've accomplished a lot off the ice. You know, it always reminds me when I love RJ and get goosebumps just like everyone else, but at the end of watching a tape like this, it you still have to face that sober reminder that all of those seasons that he called all those games ended in defeat and at best second place. And so I watch those and I enjoy it, but it also it really drives me because we've never been able to achieve the ultimate goal. And as much as we celebrate players and years, and RJ talking about his favorite year, again that favorite year ended up with a conference finals exit. So we're really focused on bringing that championship to Buffalo. And it really did start for us with changing the culture, because you can't do it if you can't attract players to come and play for you. Some of that, as I said, is more just the geography of people having a perception of Buffalo. But quite frankly, that exists in any northeastern city. It existed in Pittsburgh. What we really have, I think, done a great job at thus far is changing the culture, where we're now starting to see players, you know, not only waive their no-trade clauses, i.e. Robin Regier, but players in the league are talking about Buffalo as, you know, a destination. It would be tampering for me to engage in any talks with current players, but I am positive, certainly by the number of visiting players that have snuck peeks into our locker room, that we're gonna be very very active for years to come in terms of being able to attract the talent that we need here. So why have we been so successful off the ice and in changing this? And again, our success off the ice is wonderful, but the on ice is what drives us. But I kind of sit back and think about how have we been so successful at change, and it really comes down to three reasons. Greg touched on it by saying, you know, first we have a leader in Terry Pegula, who has a very clear vision to make this a championship organization and a championship city. There's a favorite quote of mine from Proverbs that without a vision, the people suffer. And I always say the sports fans of Buffalo and Western New York have been suffering for quite a long time. And hopefully now in Terry, we have that leader with the vision that gets us there. And Greg mentioned it too, that, you know, I guess one way to stretch out a CLA seminar is to show a half-hour video of sports. And that's another one, Steve, you might want to look into. An investigation there. Forget the copyright. How about the CLE circumvention? But, you know, the second reason that we've been so successful is that we're not really highly centralized. And this would be a quick seminar by saying Terry wrote a big check and he doesn't have any partners and he doesn't have any banks and there's your transaction for you. But from my perspective, you know, I don't have to deal with a bunch of partners that have invested money. And I know from personal experience, you know, the man or woman that invests, you know, $200,000, which is a lot of money, into a venture that's, you know, closer to $200 million. Sometimes they want to be treated more like the owner than the guy who put in all or most of the money. But I don't have any of that. I got one guy. I don't have a board of directors. I have one guy. As much as I love my friends at First Niagara, I tell them too, I don't have any bankers to deal with, so I don't have any banking covenants. So in terms of streamlining decisions and being efficient with our time, and Terry doesn't use computers, and everyone jokes about that, but as I was telling Dave on the drive here, you know, he doesn't have to worry about getting 20 emails a day and spam emails, so he's very efficient with his time too. But a lot of times, the stuff that we've done has been Terry and I sitting, and he says, oh, that's a good idea, go do it. And, you know, boy, the sense of empowerment that I get and that we give to all of our employees is really something that has completely changed our organization. We have great folks that work there, and they are very much driven by the same goal that we have, too, of winning. But they're also pretty jazzed up that they've all been empowered to do it and given whatever resources they need. You know, I remind people, you know, when I talk about how blessed I am to not only have the job that I have, which is really a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, but to be under the ownership structure and to work for a guy like Terry is really once in multiple lifetimes. You know, I tell people, you know, the only board meeting Terry I've really had is he didn't want to fly to Game 7 in Philadelphia, so he and I jumped in his GMC and drove from Buffalo. It was even more painful for me because I watched his, he has a plane, I watched his family get on his plane as I got into the GMC with Terry, knowing that they would be there and probably having a glass of wine in about an hour and a half, and I'd be eating Slim Jims and Diet Coke and chips and almonds in and around Binghamton, which ended up being true. But you know, I also got to spend 7 hours with a guy that I really admire and connect with him. And that's how a lot of the stuff gets done. We'll sort of just spitball or brainstorm on things. And we've been very, so far off the ice, I think we've been very successful. So we don't have a highly centralized organization. And I've worked at a place that's very static and very cost sensitive in my past, and I've been micromanaged, and I knew that that's not something that I never performed at my best when that took place, and so I didn't want to be that guy. And the third reason really is we have great people. You know, before the transaction took place, it was closed rather, we started to talk about, well, you know, who stays and who goes, and do we need to bring any other people in? And Terry was very adamant. He said, look, that organization has been really cost effective over the years. He used I'm being a little bit gratuitous on how blunt he was, but they've really cut. He said, when I bought a company in my past that was sort of cut to the bone, he said, what you'll find is the employees that are left, they already got rid of the people that weren't really doing one or two or three jobs. We're going to go in there, and you're not going to need to get rid of anyone. And you know, he was dead on with that. We have just had such great success unlocking, you know, the folks that we have there. And I still remember him saying that, the company that he bought, and those words, because they just completely rang true. So before this sort of turns into a lecture on the Six Sigma, let me sort of rewind the tape and let you know a little bit about how I found my way here and get this, you know, back at least on something that you can not be too embarrassed to say that you got CLE credit for. Here's my timeline. It was about a year ago I was first introduced to Terry Pegula. At the time, I had left FSN Pittsburgh in around September, and I was trying to figure out what I wanted to be when I grow up. And at that time, a guy named Cliff Benson, who was a retired partner at Deloitte, and I were friends. Cliff worked for Deloitte when I was with the Penguins back in the late 90s and early 2000s. And Cliff said, you know, we had coffee at a place, and I told him what was going on with me. And he said, well, you know, I know this guy. He just sold part of his company. He made a lot of money on it. He's a big hockey fan. And I think he might be buying a hockey team, an NHL team, and he might need somebody to spearhead the due diligence. So at the time, fortunately, I didn't have any job to go to. But they were looking for a lawyer. They were looking for somebody that had worked for a hockey team. They were looking for somebody that understood the business of television, because the Sabres produce their own, we produce our own games and we sell our own commercials. And probably most importantly, as I said, they were looking for somebody who was had some time on their hands. So for once, actually not once, but for maybe a couple times in my life, my timing was very impeccable. So in October, November, we started to put together, think about putting together a deal team and a letter of intent, a memorandum of intent. The price had already been agreed on. There was a handshake. We didn't really decide at that time what the structure was going to be, although Terry wanted it to take place very quickly. These types of transactions, and David Lowe can expound on it based on his experience, are generally take a better part of a year, if not a little bit more. And Terry was adamant that he wanted this team before the trade deadline, because he wanted to make an impact this year. From my perspective, I wasn't sure whether that was, you like to have clean breaks, and you think, well, if we wait and do this and we start July 1, then it's our team, Terry, it's your team. You can sort of start with a clean slate. And I always struggled with that of how this would work best taking over in mid-season. In hindsight, again, sort of like Terry's other observation, it was brilliant. I would absolutely recommend it to anyone, because you're able to get in there, you're able to make immediate changes that if you came in July 1 and say we're going to make these changes, people don't see them until October. So we were able to come in day one and do a lot of things right away that had a big emotional impact. The team obviously started playing great. We ended up the regular season 16-4-4, which, I'd certainly take that start out of the gate today. But that was sort of what our thought process was at the time. So the first thing we did is we got a non-disclosure agreement, and we started to work through that. At the time, I was also trying to decide what law firm we would look to. I'd sort of narrowed it to two Pittsburgh firms that I had dealt with. One of which was, it really wasn't, no offense to Sherrard, German, and Kelly, but it really wasn't so much about the law firm, but it was about David Lowe, who I had worked with at the Penguins. While I was with the Penguins from 99 to 2008, the team had been for sale for a good chunk of that time, and we actually had some form of agreement of sale three different times. And David had worked on all of those from the seller's perspective, and he'd also sold a couple other professional sports teams in the NHL and in the NHL. So we went through and we interviewed, and the one law firm, and again, I had a lot of respect for them. It was a big firm. They sort of brought in their, who all they were going to bring to the team. And I was a little bit concerned, too, because I knew Terry wanted this deal done quickly. I knew that the deal was already done, and the only way to get it done quickly was to just buy the equity rather than make it an asset sale. So I really didn't need somebody to go in there that was going to be bombastic, that was going to pick fights all the time. And sometimes, as a recovering lawyer, I know that's really hard to do. You want to just argue over stuff and say you won the argument, and in this case, that's the last thing I want, is somebody come in there and screw this deal up. So we ended up with David. He has the perfect demeanor for this. He's sort of he's not a guy that's going to negotiate something to death. He was very familiar with the NHL, with the rules that can be a little bit archaic. So I was very high comfort level that he was the right guy, and obviously I was correct. Then we went about hiring our accountants to do some of the forensic accounting and to put together sort of the models, and that was really, really important. And again, Cliff Benson was a retired Deloitte guy. He introduced me to the folks that had just come off of the Tampa Bay Lightning transaction, and those guys were dynamite. I mean, they were just they did a yeoman's amount of work, really broke it down, and not only just from an accounting perspective, but they were able to relay all of this to me with a non-accounting background, and to Terry as to, here's how this franchise works right now. Here's what you're going to walk into. So that sort of takes us to about November-ish. We completed the term sheet, obviously, in the non-disclosure agreement. And, you know, we said started to review some of the records, and it was probably in or about that time, or maybe even a little earlier, that I really gave Terry the I don't know if it was the only piece of advice, but it was probably the best piece of advice that I gave him, to both he and his wife, Kim, and that was to just stay quiet, keep your mouth shut. Don't act like an owner until you become one. And the reason I did that is because I had seen in Pittsburgh three different owners get to the same point in time. All three of them, you know, held press conferences and, you know, were very open in the media. You know, Terry is an exception in that regard because he's not a huge, he's not ego-driven by any stretch of the imagination. And more fundamentally is, you know, if you get out there over your skis too much too early, you're going to say something that can be misconstrued. And at the end of the day, we weren't running for political office. I needed 29 other owners to like Terry. That was really it. So keep your mouth shut. And so that maybe explains why, and I've said this to some of the reporters, Bucky Gleason and others that were really hot on the trail of Terry. That's why he just kept quiet. And Terry was very, not only comfortable with that, he was probably very appreciative that he could maintain his low profile. And he, you know, we actually got high marks for the commissioner whenever we had sold it. He said, I wish I could have our other owners and prospective owners do the same as what you guys did. So Terry not living in Buffalo was very helpful as well. The thing that was a little difficult is he has his daughters that do the tweets, and we sort of managed our way through that. And that's something, too, that we didn't really want to kill because, you know, that's the generation we want to connect with is the teenagers, because that's the future. And so we kind of had at least I had a bit of an uncomfortable alliance that, one, you know, I have teenage kids, and so I would look at, you know, sort of the parenting advice is, do you really want your kids doing all this stuff? And we talked about it quite a bit. And Terry viewed it, and rightly so, as this is an opportunity for our kids to learn this process as well, learn how to communicate. And quite frankly, he's okay with them making mistakes. He's okay with me making mistakes. So that's, you know, that was something that looking back through my notes, I was probably really, really nervous about. In hindsight, it probably just help make it all the more special as we move forward. So that brings me about to, you know, the point where we're really rolling up our sleeves into the due diligence. Before I turn it over to Eric to continue with it, and I'll be back up to pick up the rest of the story. The one thing that really stuck out in my mind at that time period, this is probably around December, you know, Cliff Benson and I were at a restaurant, and it was a typical Western New York day. It was dark, it was cold, it was windy, and we had to walk in about a foot of snow. No one here shovels. I it would kill people, I think, to shovel the front of their sidewalks. No one here shovels their sidewalks, so we plop our way through. I didn't have any boots. So we go to the restaurant, and Cliff said, you know, what the hell are we doing here? And I had spent enough time here, and I've obviously have a lot of friends here. I didn't hesitate, and I said, Cliff, you know, this region needs something. This region needs to feel proud about itself, and fortunately or unfortunately, it's going to be a hockey team. And no team will celebrate more, no team will cherish it more, and no team will appreciate it more, and no city will appreciate it more than when the Buffalo Sabres win it, and that's why we're going to do it. And so that's really why we're here. I like to end on a high, so that's the end of my remarks for the day. I'm not going to be back up here. But no, that's a true story, and that's really what drives me and I know the rest of our folks is that, you know, they'll name elementary schools after Terry Pegula when we win. We might not ever win another game after that, but I think at this point to talk more about, you know, from the December timeline on, I want to bring up Eric to sort of moderate from the legal side.
thanks everybody for having us up here and enjoyed the facility, and it's good to see so many old friends, not that they're old. A bunch of us, I think the last time we saw each other, we had a little bit more hair on top and a little less hair in our ears. So it's nice to see everybody. You know, I think as you can tell from Ted, and you'll hear from all of the panelists, the one thing that resounds from all of us is our love of hockey. And, you know, hockey is an addiction. It should be part of a 12-step program, frankly. You know, if you played or if you have kids that play, you know it's important. It is life-changing for us and for, I suspect, you as Sabres fans. There's something about a sport that makes you get up at 5 o'clock in the morning to go to early morning practices and keeps you there every weekend late, and for these guys, weeknights, every night late. It keeps you on the road traveling at all hours to unknown rinks all over the country, and at least in my case, are ridiculously large SUVs, which sleep 10, but you can only fit 4 people in because of our enormous hockey bags. It keeps us from noticing the unavoidable smell of wet hockey equipment that permeates our cars, clothes, garages, our whole house. It's an addiction that compels us to watch hundreds of NHL and AHL games, as well as numerous college games, high school games, and any other game that happens to be on the ice before or after my kids get on there. So it's why, after an extremely successful career, and the option to perhaps take a step back, that somebody like Terry Pegula decided to fulfill a lifelong dream of owning the Buffalo Sabres. And it's that same passion that resonates throughout the Sabres organization and its management team, and Ted and his crew, including Dave Zagai. And for those of us lawyers who are accustomed to doing, you know, less exciting transactions, let's just say, to be involved and have the opportunity to work on a sports team acquisition, work with the Sabres organization, has allowed Dave Lowe and our firm to be involved with something we're truly passionate about. So just wanted to take a step back and talk about that. So Ted left off with the kind of the due diligence phase. And so let me ask Dave Lowe. Can I call you Zig for the, yeah, they'll make it easier. Yeah. So how did SGK, how did Sherrard, German, and Kelly become involved with Terry and his team?
Well, first of all, let me just thank everyone for having us here today. I was kind of going for Sabres colors, but I think I hit the Allegheny colors, so I feel right at home, you know? But as Ted mentioned, he and I had worked together for a number of years when Ted was at the Penguins. And as he said, I think I worked on 3 different sales of the Penguins that got to various stages but never to a closing. And so I knew Ted real well. Ted knew me, what my experience was, what I could do. And I think we read in the paper one day that Terry Pegula was interested in buying the Buffalo Sabres. It was probably end of November, early December. And we have a couple of partners in our firm who do some work for Terry's company, East Resources. So I called them up and I said, you know what? I think Terry Pegula might be looking for an opportunity to buy the Sabres. You guys have a connection with East Resources. You know, is there any way we might be able to get in front of Terry and showcase our abilities? And at that time, we did not know that Ted was working with Terry. So they called Terry's general counsel, John Siminski, who had already been working with Ted, and they were already working on the letter of intent. We got an interview with Ted. Ted came in, and yeah, we talked about the deal, and I asked Ted, I said, well, what's your timeline? He said, well, you know, we'd really like to close this by the end of January. And this is early December, and I swallowed real hard. Because as Ted mentioned, in all the deals I've been involved in, NHL, Major League Baseball, Minor League Baseball, I think the shortest timeline I've been involved in is about 6 months. And a lot of them have gone much longer, year or even longer. So I'm thinking, he's crazy. But we said, we can do it. I mean, little did I know at that time that the deal was going to end up being fairly simple because of what Ted said. One owner, all cash, price is already negotiated, wants to be in before the trade deadline. And that made a lot of difference in this transaction. So a few days after I met Ted, we get the call. We're part of Team Pegula. We start working on the due diligence, send up a due diligence request list. We get a few documents over the weekend, and then we send up a team of folks. I think it was myself and one of my associates, along with three or four people from Deloitte and Touche, made a trip up to Buffalo. This is mid-December, I think. And already the media scrutiny was there, and we parked in the lot behind the arena there, and there were TV crews waiting. And I think my associate actually ended up on television one night carrying in documents as he went from the car to the arena. So we spent a couple of days in Buffalo looking through documents, touring the facility, getting to know management, just kind of getting an idea of what was going on. We all went back to our offices. Deloitte and Touche reviewed the various financial pieces of the deal. We reviewed a ton of contracts, sent back additional requests, and all of this was funneling toward a meeting with Terry in early January where we were going to present the findings of the due diligence and get the final go or no-go. And it was fairly unlikely that there was going to be a no-go, so we were primarily looking for real, real showstoppers, things that would say, don't do this deal, or that would dictate one structure or another. And as Ted said, our primary goal was speed. And speed, in this case, virtually dictated that we do this as an equity deal rather than an asset deal, because if we acquired assets, there were just a ton of contracts and other issues that would take time in order to transfer over to the new buyer. So we did our due diligence, met with Terry on Monday afternoon. We met Monday morning. We did a dry run of the presentation for Terry. Terry came in the afternoon with Kim, and we went through it for probably an hour or two. Presented him with with all the issues, with all the findings that we had. You know, we had no real showstoppers. There was one small environmental issue that Terry seemed to focus on because it was sort of in his wheelhouse as an oil and gas guy. But it turned out not to be much of an issue at all.
One of the things that was interesting about that, because I sat next to Terry that day, I'm just remembering this now, and they had a really nice book and charts and everything else, and it's funny because I look back on it even more fondly, having known Terry at the time. We were still getting to know each other as well. But at the end of David's book was sort of, here are the, he called them showstoppers, but here are the ones that, the pros and the cons. And, I could see out of the corner of my eye, Terry wrote something, there was like five bullet points, and I could see out of the corner of my eye, and I didn't want to, grab it and look at it. I did want to, but I didn't. So I was trying to look at out of my peripheral vision, which is getting worse and worse by the year. But I knew he wrote something down, so we finished and we were talking and exchanging, thank yous at the end. And I said, Terry, what'd you write down? I saw you writing something. And he showed it to me. And under the pros, at the very bottom, he said, owning your favorite team. I'll never forget. And Terry is he's a hoarder, I think. I envision that the TV show Hoarders probably has him high on their list to come and do a whole week's worth of material. But I'm sure that exists somewhere. But I just thought that, and looking back now, how charming that was and how true that was. He is a fan, and he's a smart business guy, and he's done very well for himself. But he is
You know, I tell people in Buffalo, you guys won the owner lottery.
Yeah. Yeah, Greg was talking earlier about all the connections with Allegheny College. So, funny story, when I was a young lawyer, it was in mid-80s, I started my practice out in Los Angeles with a big firm there. My wife and I were from Pittsburgh. After a couple years there, we decided to move back to Pittsburgh, and I joined a firm, a smaller firm there. My first assignment for that firm was to work on a private placement for a guy named Terry Pegula. He formed a limited partnership to raise, you know, maybe $1 million or so to drill some wells, maybe not even that much. And so I worked with him on a couple of those deals. I can remember being in his kitchen in his house in Olean, New York, back in 1984, 1985. Those, I think, were the only two deals that we did for Terry, and he moved on for whatever reason. And so the next time I saw Terry was at this meeting when we were giving this presentation to him. And so after the meeting, I walked up to Terry and I said, "Terry, do you remember?" And I told him about how I had worked with him previously. And he looked at me and he was rifling through his mind, I think, trying to remember. And I said, "Well, I used to have a mustache." And he said, "Oh, it's starting to come back to me." He said, "I can't believe it." He said, "Hey, this guy was in my kitchen." But he was a great guy then, and you know, that was back during the days that he talks about, when you know he didn't have much, and his dream was to own the Buffalo Sabres. And so, I mean, I feel fortunate to have been with him back in the early days, and now here in the in the glory days, so to speak. And but he is a great guy. He's been great to work with. Such a difference from most other owners that I've worked with of sports teams. You know, they tend to be big personalities, tend to be somewhat quirky. We had one owner who was he was trying to buy a hockey team, and had several other investors, but he was the lead owner. And I can remember one day he called my partner. He and I were working on the deal. He called my partner, and you know, he was having concerns about whether he should go forward with the deal or not. And he said, "You know, Chuck," he said, "my parents," and this is a successful businessman. He had built up a nice company, sold it, made a lot of money, but his parents were concerned that he was making a mistake by buying a hockey team. So he said, "Chuck, would you talk to my mother and tell her why this is such a good deal?" So we never had to deal with that with Terry. I mean, Terry knew what he wanted. He was very focused, and really his most important objective was to get in there before the trade deadline so he could have a hand in that, and that would not pass without his input.
Of course, in around that time, I want to bring Dave Ziegei into the conversation. At that time, you were on the other side. Our side, we were the outsiders coming in, and I know I could feel the eyeballs on us every time we walked into the office.
Well, I don't necessarily agree with that, Mr. Black. I just want to thank everyone also for having us here. I didn't go to Allegheny, but while the vignette was playing, I applied online to take a course at Allegheny College. So I feel like I'm part of the team.
Perhaps an honorary degree.
That's right. You're right from the standpoint of initially when we were involved, myself and another individual, Chuck Lamontina, basically when we're brought into the owner's office and told that that we're going to sell the team. And at that point, we were basically put in charge of gathering all the information and working with Ted and his team to provide all the due diligence, really. And in preparation for this conference, I actually looked in the file and I pulled out the old first due diligence list, and we talk about timing. The first due diligence request was 123 items. So when Dave was talking about the first due diligence request, and notice he mentioned it was a weekend. Well, we were in the offices that weekend. And quite frankly, you know, from my perspective, I just wanted to provide as much information and all the accurate information. It was, you know, a matter of recognizing that, you know, the team is going to be sold if it's an equity deal, that these people are stepping into the shoes of our current situation. And we didn't have anything to hide by any stretch of the imagination. So it was really a situation of us just working as hard and as quickly as we can to obtain all the information that was requested. Now, I was with the organization. I started approximately 7 years ago. My original position with the organization was the director of the lacrosse operations. And 3 years ago or so, the attorney who was in place left. So I jumped into that position at that point. So quite frankly, I had some learning to do myself with regards to the original leases, because the city is involved and the county is involved. So it was somewhat of a process that I had to become educated in. And the other interesting issue with regards to this is just the fact that not only are you getting involved with a hockey team, but you're getting involved with a lacrosse team. You're also getting involved with the arena and running the arena. So there's due diligence with regards to several facets of the organization that we had to become involved with. But it was certainly, I think, my personality is similar to Dave's in that I'd rather work together and get something done than butt heads and not get something done. So from that standpoint, we worked well and continue to work well on whatever projects have to be done.
Yeah, so we've worked very well with Dave. Dave was very helpful during our due diligence sessions and throughout the transaction, actually. Spent a lot of time in his office as he would explain to us, you know, the various quirks and in contracts that they had, he kind of gave us a lot of the flavor for why things were the way they were, and it was incredibly helpful. So after we had the meeting with Terry, that meeting was in the afternoon, and everyone at the meeting then jumped into cars and we caravaned up to Buffalo, and spent a couple days here doing some more due diligence. And by that time, we had gotten a draft of the purchase agreement from the sellers. That was one of the initial kind of concessions that we made, that was that the sellers could draft the agreement. So we had gotten the draft from the sellers. We went over a few of the major points during our meeting with Terry, and then while we were in Buffalo the next few days, we did begin some negotiations over some of the more significant points with the current owners. And then over the next several weeks, we sent drafts of the agreement back and forth. Any of you who've done transactional work know how that goes. There were any number of points where there were disagreement. There weren't any that we felt were showstoppers. There were some points where in a normal transaction, we would have argued over, we would have fought over, we would have dug in our heels. But in this transaction, speed, as I said, was paramount, and so on several of the points where, you know, perhaps we might have wanted to argue some more, we didn't. We just cut it off and said, okay, it's we can live with, you know, the risk that presents, or we can live with that position, because what we really want is to get this thing done and get in there. So I think we moved through January pretty quickly, and I think signed the agreement near the end of January, right?
I think it was February 1st.
February 1st, yeah. And then wound up closing basically 3 weeks later on the 22nd, which gave us about a week before the trade deadline. I think the trade deadline was February 28th, and that gave us about 6 days. One of the issues that typically comes up in these transactions and that came up here was the extent of input and control that the buyer, in this case Terry, would have over team operations between the time we signed the agreement and the time we closed. Most important, of course, to Terry was some input into player transactions, trades, signing players, that sort of thing. There's sort of a fine line that you have to walk between getting so much control that when the NHL sees the provision, they say, well, wait a minute, you know, we haven't even approved the transfer, and you're in there basically owning the team, and not having enough control that would allow the current owners to do something that Terry just wouldn't want, like trading Ryan Miller or something. So we spent some time crafting a provision that gave Terry some input over player transactions. And really nothing happened between sign and close, and then Terry got in, you know, with about 6 days left in the trade deadline and you know, obviously had some input there.
Yeah, so. And I think that when we were with the Penguins, working on the Penguins, it was, you know, you can't trade Sidney Crosby. So I think what we ended up doing is we picked that Terry could pick 10 players that couldn't be moved without his consent. I think it was 10.
Yeah, I think it was 10 players.
Of course, Terry, you know, Terry jots it down. I'm positive that sheet of paper exists somewhere in his, I call it his computer. It's his giant day planner that he carries around. But I'm positive that exists, and maybe if it becomes valuable, we'll auction it off for charity or something.
Right. So one of the other one of the other concerns we had here was just getting through the NHL approval process quickly. And certainly Ted was a huge help in that because he had great relationships with the NHL executives, with Gary Bettman, with Bill Daly, with David Zimmerman, and he really prepared the way well. And so as soon as we signed the agreement, I think that day, or you know, if you know, there might have been a 12-hour delay, but we submitted our application to the NHL pretty much immediately, and it. That again was a much simpler process than in normal sports transactions. All the sports leagues really do a lot of due diligence on all of the owners. So if you have a group of owners, they want to look at everybody. They do background checks, criminal checks, litigation checks. They want to see that you have the financial resources that you say you have, and they look back to every ultimate owner. So if you have a corporation as one of the owners, they look to every direct and indirect owner, and you've got to submit the same information for each and every one of those persons. So the fact that we were dealing with just one person, Terry, made this so much easier. Had there been a group of owners, there's probably no way we could have gotten this done in that time frame, because the background checks alone would have taken much longer. And then typically the background checks reveal things that the league has questions about, and they ask you to respond to that, and what about this litigation, and what about that, and they're really looking to make sure that their owners are people that they're proud to have as owners and aren't involved in industries like gaming, the porn industry, that sort of thing, don't have skeletons in their closet that would be embarrassing to the league. And fortunately we had pretty much the perfect owner here. Just a clean slate, great guy, great background, and that went really well.
Terry is abnormally normal, is what I like to say.
Plus, at that time, I think the NHL had learned their lesson because of the Phoenix situation and just the fact that they had gone through a couple different owners and had some problems there. So. As David said, when they saw Terry, I think it was refreshing compared to what that they had been going through. So they recognized also, I believe they wanted to get him before the board, before the trade deadline. So there was another reason to move the process along even further, which prompted them to actually not shorten, but expedite their process for doing their due diligence on the owner.
And the leagues exert a lot of control over teams. They require owners to agree to a lot of provisions that, at least in other situations, owners have really had difficulty accepting. That the league can step in certain situations and take certain actions that you wouldn't normally find in other industries. But in this industry, it's like a regulated industry. It's like owning a TV station or a railroad. There's government oversight there, and here there's NHL oversight. And a couple times we had to go to Terry and his folks and explain, well, here's what the league wants and here's what it means, and that all turned out fine, and Terry understood it and Terry agreed to it. But in other situations, there's been more of a struggle getting owners to accept the fact that, you know what, you're in a club and you've got to play by the club's rules. And but I don't anticipate any of those will be an issue at all for Terry going forward.
Ted, can you talk a little bit about the, you mentioned about media rights and TV coverage. What role does that play in the valuation process, or you know, how does the team optimize that?
Well, it's an important revenue stream for any team, the local TV rights. You get more money from your local TV rights, in our case MSG, than you do from national rights. It's the perfect model from an owner standpoint and a revenue standpoint is what the NFL has, and that's a national TV deal. And each team, gets a pro rata participation in that, and I think it's probably closer to $200 million a year than $1 million a year that the teams get. Ours is much lower than that. And NFL teams, they can go out and shop their own preseason package to local telecasters, so that's why you'll see the preseason games be on local TV. For us, it's very important in our case, we're tied to a longer term deal, so we obviously had to understand what the agreements permitted and what they didn't permit. I was obviously familiar with that, being on both sides of the industry, having worked at a TV station and worked for a team. So what you want to do is, and we're a little bit unique in that we the Sabres, produce the games and we go out and sell the commercial inventory. So that's probably an area where I early on have identified as a potential growth area to just maximize more from our the amount that we get selling TV commercials. But it's very important. The radio deal is an important revenue stream, but it's a decimal place or two less. We just renewed ours with WGR. We have a wonderful relationship with them. That renewal will kick in next year. We did it a year early. Very happy with where that ranks within the league for a market our size. I think it puts us probably above most other markets.
Now, Zig, after you take a drink of water, can you describe the players, coaches, and kind of front office reaction to, knowing or believing that a potential sale was going to take place, and how does that play into?
Well, again, from the front office standpoint, I thought we actually kept a pretty good lid on this for at least 2 months or so before it sort of squeaked out. But there's always rumors that are swirling around, especially when the folks started showing up in our office, then the cat was out of the bag. Prior to that, I thought we did a pretty good job of keeping the lid on it and continuing day-to-day operations. Once, obviously, everyone started showing up and there were rumors about the sale, again, you've just got to try to be as professional as you can. We're so lucky to be in this industry that you really have to put your best foot forward no matter what the circumstance. And that's what I think we've done with the employees in the organization. And again, we were lean prior to Ted coming in. We were a lean organization.
Well, that's
supposed to mean. No, I'm saying from the standpoint of
I drove you down here.
Looks like I'm going back to Pennsylvania.
Yeah, that's right.
Everybody recognized and they were appreciative of the fact of where they were. So I really think the professional standard, your pride has to take over and recognize that, I'm going to continue to do my job, do the best I can, show these people actually what I have the capability of doing. That's what, at least from my perspective, you can look at it from the front office standpoint. Obviously, from a player hockey standpoint in the locker room, you'd hope that that's the same situation. I didn't have as much access to that. But again, during the time period where you have the due diligence process, you have to continue to do the contracts, whatever else arises, take care of in the best manner that you can.
Yeah, Dave was actually quite busy during that time because we were, I think we were up there right before the World Juniors hockey tournament. And, we were there doing due diligence and asking Dave to do, a million things for us. And meanwhile, he and the front office staff were trying to get ready for the World Juniors tournament, which was a big deal and, taking up a lot of their time. So it was a challenge, I'm sure.
Yeah, no, exactly. I forgot about that. The World Juniors were, I think, 10 days, the first week of January. So in addition to working with these folks, we had to make sure that everything was taken care of on the World Junior front. So the legal team of one got through the stretch, and we're happy to be sitting here. I'm so happy with that, Ted, by the way. That's okay.
We talked a little bit about the NHL league approvals, not necessarily with this transaction, but with other transactions. What other types of third-party approvals are typically involved in a transfer of a team?
Well, probably the biggest one that is typically involved, normally the arena or the ballpark or the stadium that the team plays in is owned by either the city, the county, or some sort of authority and is leased to the team. And fairly typically there's a provision in the lease that requires approval of the authority or of the county, the city, for a transfer of the lease. And one of the reasons we did an equity deal was the lease for what was then HSBC Arena did not require any specific approval if we were doing an equity deal, because there was no transfer of the lease. The same entity continued to lease the arena from the authority. But often that's an issue, and often there's a process to go through, and it makes the deal more public than you'd otherwise like. And fortunately, in this case, we did not have to go through any sort of approval process with the local authorities. Aside from that, you know, there are your typical third-party contracts, and if you do an asset deal, you know, many of those would require consent. Probably the more significant contracts are a contract that you might have with a concessionaire, contracts with local unions, contracts for sponsorships, naming rights was a big one in our case.
Bart Scott.
Yeah. Right. Right. We had to make a filing under the Hart-Scott-Rodino Act, and that was one of the timing concerns that we had, because there's a sort of a waiting period there. So we did file the Hart-Scott filing pretty much as soon as we signed the agreement, and we got the waiting period terminated early, I think within 10 or 12 days. So that was not an impediment to moving forward, but it was an issue that we really paid very, very close attention to. We brought in some experts in Hart-Scott matters to really help us navigate the FTC and the Justice Department, and they did a great job.
I think I just add one point to that. I don't think I'm speaking out of turn. We did have one, we had a non-relocation. Mr. Pegula had to agree that he would not relocate the team as a contingency to purchasing it, and that was an agreement with the county. And or the city, I can't remember which one, but that was basically the only time we got public entities involved, is to affirm the fact that upon the purchase, he's not going to relocate the team. And the National Lacrosse League. We also another league that we had to get approval for.
Yeah, the non-relocation agreement is pretty typical these days. Most cities, if they're going to invest money in building an arena or a stadium, want to make sure that they've got a team there that will be there for a while, and so there is a non-relocation agreement here in place here, and really in most cities now. It's very typical.
So, Ted, maybe you want to talk about deals done, and now we're into it, and what the future and
the rest of the story,
right?
Well, I'm going to come up there, because it's a long story. So it was funny listening to some of the stuff, because I forget some of it if it's not in front of me. So some of this was a refresher for me. And so where David said, you know, he had Terry and I and Kim and Deloitte in for the presentation, he said, you know, after the presentation, Ted and Terry and Kim and Cliff jumped in a car. That's probably a good place to pick it up.
is, because at that time I was, you know, a consultant for Terry. I had a consultant, independent contractor agreement. And I knew what I wanted to be when I grow up, too. I wanted to work for this guy, and I wanted to come up and work for the Sabres. So on the ride up, and I'll never forget it, it's right as you get on 90, almost before you get to where MTR Gaming is, we're having a conversation, and Terry looks back and said, you know, Ted, what are your aspirations after this transaction? And I said, you mean after you buy the team and it's yours? And he said, yeah. I said, well, I'd like you to hire me to be the president of the Sabres, and I'll move up to Buffalo and help you win the Stanley Cup, which was, for me, it was a random act of clarity. you know, and Terry just, you know, he does this thing with his teeth, that, like he'll suck air between his teeth like he's trying to get something out. So he did that and said, well, I can't do it by myself. And then we didn't say anything else about it, because I was like, you know, I come home and I told my wife that, and she's like, what does that mean? And I said, I don't know, but I'm just going to show up, I guess. So, you know, we did clarify it. I went down to Florida in January to put together what I called the Pegula playbook, which was to map out the first 100 days pretty much almost by the day, and then to map out the first year of what we wanted to accomplish. And one of the things on my list was, you know, make sure we understand what Ted's doing and, you know, his compensation and a contract, which we all got resolved when we were down there. And again, I'm still learning Terry Pegula at that time. And we're down in his Florida office. And I'm also learning Kim Pegula at this time, too, because this is really the first that she had started to be active. I think that was the first I'd ever met her, was probably in your office in January. So Kim is, you know, she's focused. I had put together this 15-page outline, the Pegula playbook. I was really proud of the alliteration. And Terry focused. Well, Terry's kind of in and out. He's really interested in players, and he doesn't want to talk to me. He wants to talk to the GM. And so at one point I look over, and I see Cliff Benson and Kim, and, you know, where the hell is Terry? And I looked over, and he's rolling around on the floor with his dog, Sydney. And I just said, you know, so this is the team that's going to win the Stanley Cup for Buffalo. Yeah. You know, it's like, you wanted me to be my latex salesman moment. So we went down there, and we went over it. And the other thing that he fixated on, too, and is that I didn't put numbers at the bottom of the page. And he continued to remind me the entire meeting. So finally I grabbed his and handwrote them all in. But I never give him a multi-page document that doesn't have numbers at the bottom. And if those are his only two idiosyncrasies, playing with a dog and being fixated on numbers, then I'm doing okay. February 1st or ish, we closed on the transaction, but we still have to wait for NHL approval. Terry and I went down to the All-Star game and met with the executive board, which that's the process you go through. You meet with the executive board of the NHL, which is a subset of the owners, and they interview Terry. And I remember it was Jeremy Jacobs, who's from Buffalo, and Jeremy saw Terry in the hallway, and he said, you know, Terry, we're going to make a millionaire out of you. It took me that long, too. I'm glad that's sort of my quickness test. For those of you who didn't pick up on it, Terry is a billionaire, so making him a millionaire is a bad thing. So Terry was approved with flying colors. I mean, I think the NHL won the owner lottery as well that day. February 21st, Terry gives his speech. You know, he doesn't tell anyone what he's going to say, other than I'm kind of horrified when he tells me the night before that he's got about 25 minutes worth of material, and I'm thinking, oh man, this is not going to be good. But it was better than good. It was great. It's one of the most memorable speeches I think anyone has probably delivered in that context. People don't seem to remember that I talked that day too, but I didn't cry when I saw Gilbert Perreault. And so no one seems to remember that. But I talked about two things. One, I talked about making Buffalo a destination. And I talk about, I use the phrase, I want to make Buffalo hockey heaven. and that was where a place where, and I talk about being over your skis too. We're going to be the destination where people waive their no trade clauses to come and play, which had I don't think had ever happened before. But that was our goal. Terry was very matter of fact, we're going to win the Stanley Cup, and we talked about that before and said, do you really want to say that? And he said, no, if we don't say it, we're not going to do it. So we're not going to pussyfoot around it. So then we started to undertake the million little things that we wanted to do to change the franchise. Terry said winning isn't a goal, it's a belief, but belief without hard work and deeds is really an empty pursuit. So the first thing we did was we opened an online suggestion box, and those of you who've heard me speak before will pardon me for this, but open an online suggestion box. Fans, we want your ideas. We're going to look at them all and execute as many as we can. The first week, I was really excited because we got 1,000. And again, at this time, I checked into a hotel on February 21st. I was away from my family, sort of like, Danny, I probably like being traded and you're living in a hotel now. Those are long days and a lot of idle time. So I thought, oh, great, I can read these fan suggestions, which was a great exercise too, because I feel like I am telepathic with our fans on that level. So first week I kept up and I had to speak at something and I said, I'm going to read everyone. The next week the list was 2,500. I thought, okay, well, I'm not going to get to watch Seinfeld reruns tonight. I'll do that. So I read through them, and then eventually it got up to about 30,000. And I quit around 8,000. I think the last ones batch I read was probably around the playoffs last year, and I was really excited because, and I have it, I still have the scrap of paper, talking about Terry being a hoarder, I have the scrap of paper from the Philadelphia Hotel for the guy, because they all started to fall into the same cadence. And some guy said, the cotton candy is blue and red. Our team colors are blue and gold. Can we make all the cotton candy the same color? And I was so excited that I've got a different idea. I mean, so I didn't read 20,000 of them, but we parted ways with Tim Connolly, and I'd like to say I probably didn't need to read the other 20,000 trade Tim Connolly suggestions either. So here's a quick list of some of the things that we did right away, some of them are small, but a lot of small things can be pretty helpful as well. But the first thing we did is produce a game night magazine to give away for free to the fans, and the Pegula effect can take a good idea and make it great. And the one thing that Kim did to make that idea great is she said, let's go down and hand it out to the fans as they're coming in. So Kim's family and mine would do that. I still do it. She did it last week as well. And it gives you an opportunity to not only personally thank the fans, but to talk to them as well and get some feedback. In or about the time that we were doing that, I had also brazenly stood up and said, we're going to kill the slug logo. I don't know if we see any slugs here today, but the slug logo, fans hated that one, so I said we're going to kill it. So I'm down there handing out programs, and I see everyone has a slug logo. And I'm thinking, especially the kids that have like really new jerseys, and I'm thinking their parents must hate me. Mr. Black said this is a bad jersey, Mom, go buy me a new one for $100. So that was really the reason why we said we're gonna have a slug appreciation day where we do something to thank the fans. And we actually did that in September, and we offered a 41% discount on, it ended up being everything in the store, but the concept was if you come in with a slug hat, you get a 41% off a slug hat, and our store got pretty well overwhelmed. We ended up doing, on a gross basis, because it was a significant sale, on a gross basis, we did 10% of what we do in an entire year in one day for a preseason. And that was really cool as well because it also gave us another opportunity to interact with the fans. I went down there and I saw the lines were like 40 minutes long and I started to panic and say, oh man, this, no good deed goes unpunished. People are going to be pissed about doing this. So I went upstairs and got the accounting department and Kim Pegula was in town. She came down and a couple other people came down and we bagged merchandise for the better part of a day. I think I worked for about 4 or 5 hours. I think Kim Pegula was there for about 8 hours. You know, standing around in high heels like that is a killer, and I can only imagine what Kim felt like. So, that's none of your business. That wasn't one of Steve's stories either. We didn't have drag racing at the fraternity house. So we killed the slug. We painted I saw the rose-colored interior. We painted that blue and gold. Fans asked for a way to alleviate the congestion when you're coming from the concourse in, so that's why we did the three chime with 2 minutes to go. And, you know, that's another one, too, that Terry, when he first heard that, he's like, what is that? And I explained to him. I said, you know, when you go to the opera, you hear these chimes, and it's time to go back to your seat. And he's like, yeah, that's... He used a word I'm not going to use. And so we're riding back down on the elevator, and the guy... A guy was between Terry and me, his back to me, and he said, oh, Mr. Pegula, thank you so much for buying the team and all you've done, and welcome, and, you know, thanks so much for giving us those chimes, too, to know when to go back to your seat. And, you know, I'm behind Terry. This time I know Terry a little bit better, too, so I'm behind him just, like, giving him my best smart-ass smile, and he's just kind of like, you know, okay, thank you. Another big suggestion we had, we found out that the women's restrooms had no hot water, which was really weird. And the fixation, I don't know whether I want to paint people from Jamestown with the same brush, but people in Buffalo are fixated with the bathrooms. They wanted cup shelves above the urinals, flat screen TVs. Some guy wanted a couch in there. You know, the hot water, I understand. I'm not sure I understand why you want to hang out figuratively in the bathroom. I was doing a check. So we did it. We fixed the hot water, and it was just turning valves. It was kind of something silly. But I went in and had to check it out. I went in when no one was there. And checked out the women's restroom. Danny Gare's phone number was in some of the stalls. And it was in his own handwriting. So, but I was doing a chat last week or the week before, and somebody said, you know, Mr. Black, thank you so much for putting flat screens in the men's restroom. The problem is when you're standing in the row of the urinals, the flat screens are down the aisle on each aisle, and I'm just really uncomfortable, you know, looking down that way. And so I typed back and said, dude, the flat screens are 10 feet in the air. Keep your eyes up. So some of the other things that we've done is... We moved the smoking section. We're actually thinking about maybe making our entire property smoke-free. We haven't done that yet, but we're trying to figure that out because where it was located before is the smoke would seep into the store. And again, I had a lot of suggestions of people saying, you know, I bought a baby outfit and I brought it home and it smelled like an ashtray. And, you know, those are the things when you read it in my position, that stuff really sticks in your head as a parent, that's pretty gross. So we're looking to find a solution for that. Another fan suggestion, you know, talking earlier about WGR, they launched an FM station last year, and one of the fans wrote in and said, I work night shifts, and I work in a shop where I can't get AM because of the interference. WGR has a sister station, and it's an FM. Is there any way to put the signal on there? And I called WGR, and I said, you know, surely you guys have thought about that. And he said, no, that's a great idea. We can do that. So that was one where, you know, one fan wrote in and said, can you put it on the FM station? And it prompted a conversation, and credit GR, too. They quickly did it. So that's why we're on FM. There's some guy working in a machine shop called in and asked. Honor Rick Jenneret, a lot of those. We do RJ calls after goals in the arena. We have a loop outside in the plaza of RJ's calls and Ted Darling calls. I don't know if you notice it at all, but next time you're walking through the plaza to come in, that runs on a 20-minute loop. Rick Jenneret was elected into the Buffalo Sabres Hall of Fame, and he'll be honored this month against Winnipeg. I don't have that date. I don't know, Dan, if you know that one. November 8th, RJ's going to be honored at the game. That'll be exciting. Have players... deliver season tickets was one. That's one that we did in takes from our Pittsburgh playbook that we used to do that, and it's always very well received. What was a little different is, unlike any other city, we had our owner delivering season tickets, and we wanted to make it special, not so much for us, but for the pageantry of the people arriving at houses. We got limousines, and Terry is not a limousine guy. He's like, I'm not riding in a limousine, I'm driving. So I rode in the, it was Kim and Terry, I rode in the back seat with Jess, and we went to deliver tickets, and we actually delivered tickets to somebody who had Terry's old seats, his actual seats, because he was a season ticket holder, which was really cool. We hung out and had a couple beers there, Terry, who he doesn't like being around groups of people. He just doesn't like the limelight. He likes the focus to be on the players and the team. I guess I fall to the other end of the spectrum. But he ended up actually walking down to the guy's elementary school with him to pick up his daughter, which was really cool. Not that Terry did it, but just to see the expressions on people's faces when he's walking through North Tonawanda to go into somebody's elementary school. But that was a really special day, again, it was a nice fan suggestion as well. Probably the biggest project that we've undertaken has to do with the players. We undertook a 30,000 square foot renovation of our locker room. If you just imagine little bulldozers inside of the bowels of the arena and how difficult that was from a logistics standpoint, and we were moving, bathrooms, and so water. Pipes had to be moved all over the place, and we got that done. We really probably went right down to the wire whenever we were in Europe, but it's really cool to see, other players from other teams kind of sneaking peeks in there, and as I said earlier, I think that the word is already out that Buffalo is the place you want to come and play. We got the best owner. It's the fans speak for themselves, and the commitment is absolutely there. That commitment also extends to the alumni, as Danny can maybe elaborate on when he talks. Last year was the 40th anniversary of the team, and it really wasn't, it wasn't Terry's team all of last year. So we talked about, how do we honor the 40th anniversary? Should we honor the 40th anniversary? And we decided, said, well, what if we bring back every living alumni? What if we did that? That would be really cool. Pittsburgh did that when they closed Mellon Arena. So we looked at it, and it was, it was going to be like over $100,000 of expense and zero revenue attached to it. And so I was kind of, maybe try to nudge Terry into, we really don't, really don't need to do this if you don't want to. He quickly shut me up and said, no, we're doing it. That's the relationship we want to have with these guys. So we invited all living alumni back. 85 came back, and it ended up costing about $125,000. It was one of the coolest regular season events I've ever attended. And it was just to see the emotion, the thousands of the people that were outside, we were blessed with a beautiful day. We were blessed with an awesome game. That night was, the game that we beat Philadelphia in overtime. And if you remember, about 45 seconds left in the game, Philadelphia just didn't challenge us, and we held the puck in our own end until I think Steve Monador wanted to go coast to coast with about 10 seconds left, and we all had heart attacks over that. But that was an awesome event, and I heard this story after the fact. If you want to fast forward a little bit to after we traded for after we traded for Robin Regier, and he had a no trade clause. I had heard an interview from Rhett Warner on the radio, and he said he was reluctant to come back. He was one of the last ones that RSVP'd for the alumni event, and he said, when I was there, I sent a text to my friend Robin Regier and said, you should come and play here. This is a great place for you. You'll love this owner. You'll love these fans. You should play here. And Robin at the time had 2 years left on his, one, he was under contract, two, he had 2 years remaining on his contract. And I thought, when I heard that, and Robin, we did trade for him, and it took a while, and Terry flying up to see him, but he did waive his no-trade clause. And I thought, you know, if his salary is $4 million a year, we'll just call it $4,125,000 a year, and we still got a pretty good deal on it. And when Robin came in, and he lives in the city, he lives in the Elmwood area. They love it here. And when I first met him, and I told him this story, and I said, you know, you're the first guy that's waived his no-trade clause, and I'm very confident we're going to look back at that being our tipping point. That, you know, that's when we knew we had sort of broken through the misperception of Buffalo, and that we're going to start to maybe be able to be a lot more selective when people come to us saying that they want to come and play here, and maybe they'll take a haircut too to play for a little bit less. So that takes my personal timeline to about June. And June 27th was a fantastic day for me because I checked out of room 430 of the Embassy Suites, thereby setting the all-time endurance record of 126 nights. And by the way, if you're curious as to what you get for staying there that long, you get one night stay anywhere, which I used it. We were in Spain over the summer, so I stayed at the Madrid Airport Embassy Suites for 126 nights. June 27th and 28th, my wife and I began the process of moving into our new home in Buffalo. June 29th, Terry announced his purchase of the Rochester Americans. I chuckle not because out of disrespect for Rochester, but you know, it's not like we didn't have enough on our plates at the time. June 30th, we traded for and then signed Christian Ehrhoff to a 10-year contract. July 1, we signed Ville Leino to a 6-year contract. And July 3rd to the 6th, I was now the president of the Rochester Americans, which I didn't do a very good job negotiating my contract because I don't get anything for that. But I do love it, and I love the AHL. It's a fantastic league with fantastic people. So it was nice to reconnect with a lot of those folks at the annual meeting. From a business perspective, probably the most significant thing that we've done is in August we reached an agreement between and among the Sabres and First Niagara and HSBC to rename the arena, the First Niagara Center. And you know, this deal not only is a good deal financially for us, it's nice to align yourself with good partners, and we could not have picked better partners than First Niagara. When I told Terry, I was so eager to tell Terry because I was very proud, one, that we got this done so quickly, and the terms that we got were very favorable. And he said, well, okay, that's all good. Tell me what kind of people they are. So I said, well, you're going to really like these guys, Terry. I mean, it's a Lockport bank, a little corner bank in Lockport that's now about the 50th largest bank in the United States, and they're really good people. And he's like, good, okay. No, I still have yet to get my attaboy, but I'm not done fishing for it either. And then, you know, last week we ceremonially lit the First Niagara Center. You know, talk about deals that take a long time. In 60 days, you know, thanks to these guys here, Those aren't easy deals to do either. There's a lot of lawyers involved. We not only put the deal together, but we changed out all of our signage, First Niagara, in 60 days. And I know from personal experience, and I know Dave Lowe worked on it when I was with the Penguins. These take months and months and months to do and to execute. So that really takes us up till about the time I stood up here to talk. And it's all I can say is it's been a really wonderful 8 months. I'm really glad that we're into the season, so I can stop talking about, you know, to paraphrase RJ, it's time for me to stop talking about top urinal shelves and talk about top shelf goals, which is a lot more interesting. So I really appreciate it. And as I said when I first came up here, I most of all appreciate the warmth and the welcoming nature of Western New York. It's been fun, and I can't wait till we win the Stanley Cup.